Hello, and welcome to LUMC's weekly worship service. We're so happy to have you join us this morning. Today, Pastor Brandon is going to continue our series called The Chosen, Season 4, and show us a moment in Episode 2 that will transform the way we see a familiar passage in the Bible. But before that, we're going to begin our service with some music. Join me, and let's sing together. Amen. Now, before we get into the rest of our service, I'd like to share with you a few announcements. Right now, take a look at that button on the right that says Connection Card. go ahead and click that button and fill one out, even if you'd filled one out before. The connection card is a great resource. It's a way to register your attendance and let us know that you're here with us today. It's a great way to take next steps and sign up for activities in the church. And most importantly, it's a way to share your prayer requests with us. Every Monday, Pastor Brandon prays over all of the prayer requests we get and will reach out to you to let you know that he's prayed for you. So please, take a moment right now to fill that out. Now, after you've done that, go ahead and click the link that says Give Online. Every week, our church is blessed to be able to change lives through our online ministry, just like this worship service, and through our work in the community. That impact is made possible through your gifts, so thank you so much for giving. And if you'd like to continue to support the work of LUMC, just click that link and you'll see a variety of ways that you can give. Finally, our annual night at the Triple R Ranch will be this Saturday, October 12th. Bring your family as we enjoy laser tag, hay rides, and much more. Also, if you or your kids want to come back for even more fun, sign up for our youth retreat at Triple R from November 1st through 3rd. The Bible retreat is for middle school, high school, and adult chaperones, and will have activities such as horseback riding and archery. It'll be great. Now, for this week's message, Pastor Brandon is going to continue our series called The Chosen Season 4 and show us a moment in Episode 2 that will transform the way we see a familiar passage in the Bible. Let's watch.
When you were a kid, did you ever go somewhere where you weren't supposed to go? Like explore some abandoned house in your neighborhood, or ride your bike too far away from home, or get into the ocean when you weren't supposed to? Well, when I was a kid, I remember one time when my cousin did this. My aunt was babysitting me and my cousins, and we ordered pizza, and for some reason, my aunt's boyfriend was around, so he offered to go pick it up. And at one point, he asked if anyone wanted to go with him, and one of my cousins said yes. There was only one problem. She was 7 years old. Now, nothing happened. They just went and got pizza. I mean, it didn't even really seem like that big of a deal to me or to my aunt who was babysitting us. But when my cousin's mom heard about it, she freaked out. Because in her mind, there was no way that her daughter should have been in that situation. And maybe you feel the same way when you hear that story. Well, I want to show you a story today of a moment when people felt the exact same way about something Jesus did. See, in the story we're going to look at, Jesus takes his disciples to a place where they definitely should not be. I mean, they would have been seriously uncomfortable in this place, but when they get there, they experience one of the most powerful lessons in the Bible. And so, to continue our series on The Chosen Season 4, let's watch this clip from Episode 2.
Come, come. Rabbi, this place.
Respectfully, Rabbi, why did you bring us here? It's an abomination.
It's a pretty strong word, Andrew.
Rabbi, during Shiva?
Should we avoid dark places out of fear? Or should we be light to them, like Simon and Judas were on their mission? You think my cousin would be afraid of this cave? Do you think he would be so appalled by what happens in that temple over there that he couldn't stand to be in this place? Who do people say the Son of Man is?
Uh,
Some say you are Elijah, the one who preaches repentance.
Others say Jeremiah, because he was rejected by the leaders of his time.
And still others say one of the prophets, those that spoke on God's behalf.
Okay, what are we gonna have to do, huh? Cast lots? Nathaniel, this is your moment. Be yourself.
Some say John the Baptizer.
Which obviously isn't true.
Okay. Well, that's everyone else. But who do you say that I am?
You? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. These carved statues of Baal and Pan and other idols that we passed, they're dead and decaying, but we worship a living God, and you, you are his son.
Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. All your life, you've been called Simon, one who hears. But today, I call you Peter. Rock.
And it is on this rock that I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it.
So what you just saw in this clip is the day when Jesus decided to take his disciples on a field trip. And strangely enough, I'm not really kidding when I use that phrase. I mean, there are many times when Jesus and his disciples travel to heal and perform miracles, but not on that day. That day was all about education. Jesus has something that he wants to teach his disciples, and he's taking them to a place that will get this lesson across to them in a powerful way. Jesus takes his disciples to a place called Caesarea Philippi. And Caesarea Philippi is about 25 miles away from Galilee. But more importantly, Caesarea Philippi is a pagan temple. In fact, Jesus' disciples would have been very uncomfortable going to this place. The Jewish law is very clear about getting too close to pagan practices. In Leviticus, God says, "Do not turn to idols or make metal gods for yourselves. I am the Lord your God." I mean, Jews aren't even really supposed to associate with pagans, lest they be led away from the Lord. Throughout the Old Testament, you see one story after another warning of this, demonstrating the dangers that can befall the people if they are drawn too close to pagan practices and pagan gods. Well, it's those who are punished or miss out on the Lord's blessing who do these things, and the general practice at the time was stay away from all things pagan. And yet, here, Jesus leads them straight to these pagan premises, because Jesus wants to make a point, and they have to see it to understand it. You see, Caesarea Philippi had a long history of pagan worship. In the days of the Old Testament, Caesarea Philippi was a region that had been overrun with the worship of Baal. And closer to the time of Jesus, Caesarea Philippi was the site of the world's largest temple to the pagan god Pan. Pan was a god of fertility, and Caesarea Philippi reflected this. People would gather to perform all sorts of fertility rituals. Giant phallic symbols would be placed in apses and other locations around the temple to honor this god Pan. Smaller statues were placed around for his nymphs, and it was believed that this would entice him to mate with them, and this would cause all people to be blessed with fertility. But for the same reason, the people also performed their own fertility rituals, rituals involving temple prostitutes, goats, since Pan was a goat, and other deplorable things. I mean, if you were to ask a Jew in Galilee what was the darkest, most wicked place they knew of, most would have probably mentioned Caesarea Philippi. But there was another spot in Caesarea Philippi that cast an equally, if not greater, darkness: the gates of hell. You see, Caesarea Philippi sits at the base of Mount Hermon. It's a lush area filled with lush foliage and streams of water. And one of these streams led into a cave called the Gates of Hades. Inside of this cave, there was a deep chasm into which water fell, and people believed that this chasm led directly to the underworld. It was a gate into Hades. And because of this, those who worshipped there believed that this gave them a unique access to the gods that they worshipped. They believed that their lewd acts would draw out these gods and entice them to act on their behalf. But here's the thing, the gods weren't the only ones who were worshipped in this place. Because remember, the name of this site is Caesarea Philippi. And that's because it was renamed to honor a new god, the emperor. See, not long before Jesus was born, Herod the Great, and later his son Philip, began converting it into temples and other shrines devoted to worshiping the Roman emperor, Caesar. Hence, Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea for Caesar and Philippi for Herod's son, Philip. This was a place that proclaimed that the emperor was a god worthy of worship. And so it is in light of all of that that we now can look at the moment where Jesus does these things, where he takes his disciples. You see, as you saw in the show, Jesus takes his disciples to this pagan place of worship and debauchery, perhaps even during a festival to the god Pan. And he says this, he says, "Now when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he began asking his disciples, saying, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?'" So just imagine this, right? In the midst of all this pagan worship, Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And the disciples know what Son of Man is a reference to, right? It's a reference to the Messiah. So all these people below are worshiping these gods that they believe will save them from infertility and save the empire. And Jesus asks, "Who do people say that your Savior is?" And look at how the disciples reply. And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." In other words, people are saying all kinds of things. Right? There's lots of rumors floating around. And so Jesus gets even more pointed with his question. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And notice what Jesus does here. He says, "Who do you say that I am?" He's making it very clear that he is the Messiah. You see, in this temple devoted to pagan gods, he says, "Who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter responded and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, pay close attention, because I don't want you to miss this. Simon Peter says, "You are the Christ," which is another word for Messiah, right? But then look at what he says after that. He says, "You are the Son of the living God." Peter's saying, unlike all these other gods here, right? Unlike Pan and Baal, unlike this emperor who claims to be a son of God, you are the Son of the living God, the true God, the real God. They are imposters, but you are the true one that we should worship. Now, what's really important to know here is that in Mark's gospel especially, this is the first time that any disciple has proclaimed who Jesus truly is. This is a huge statement that Peter is making. But then I want you to see what Peter says next, because this is something that has confused people for thousands of years. Matthew's gospel continues, "And Jesus answered and said to him, 'Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it.'" Do you see how the setting changes things? Do you see how it puts everything in perspective? Jesus is saying, "Simon, Peter, you get it. You realize who I truly am. This is what the world believes in, but you know who the true Messiah is. They believe in all this, but you believe in me. They see false gods, but you see the true God. And at the foot of this mountain, this massive rock, at the bottom of which is this deep cavern called the Gates of Hades, Jesus says, 'On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it.'" These words aren't random, my friends. For the disciples, all sorts of things are clicking as they hear these words. Because often, when we hear Jesus' words, we think Jesus is saying that hell can't overpower the church. But think about the setting. They're looking at the gates of Hades, right? The church doesn't have the gates. Hades has the gates. And the word Jesus uses here for overpower is this Greek word katiskuo, which means to be strong or to be strong enough. And so what Jesus is really saying here is hell, Hades, won't overcome us. He's saying the gates of Hades can't hold us back. The gates of Hades aren't strong enough to resist us. We are going to conquer Hades. We're going to conquer this false worship, this prostitution and debauchery and depravity, these empty things that people are putting their hopes in. We're going to conquer that. This is the mission of the church. I mean, let me ask you, where have you seen the church forgetting that? Where have you seen the church forget its mission? Where have you seen us squabbling with each other rather than going after the gates of Hades? Right? Where have you seen us arguing, Christians arguing over what kind of bread we have at communion or what kind of carpet we put on the floor or some disagreement we have over tiny theological details while the gates of Hades are still holding strong? Because Jesus is saying, we're going after that and it can't hold us back. I mean, some of you know what it's like to live at the gates of hell. You've been looking to this thing and that thing to save you. You've been turning to this God or that God. You might not call them gods. You might call them money or power or satisfaction. But you're putting your hopes there and you're finding nothing but emptiness. Jesus is looking at you and me and saying, I can save you from that. I'm here to free you from that emptiness, from that pain, from that void. I'm here to bring you true salvation. And if that's something you're longing for, I want to invite you to pray with me right now. If you're longing to defeat the gates of Hades in your life, if you're longing to see the church become who Jesus calls us to be, people who will attack the gates of Hades, who know our mission and stop getting distracted, people who put an end to poverty and suffering and darkness in this world, then join me right now in a prayer. Lord Jesus, we come to you and we humble ourselves in this moment. We know that as a church, sometimes your people have gotten lost. Sometimes we get distracted. We forget our mission. We become blind to the gates of Hades around us. We focus on things that don't matter, and we haven't always been faithful enough in proclaiming your good news to the world. Lord, I know that there are some of us praying right now who are suffering, hurting, feeling the pain of Hades in their lives. Living in hell on earth, suffering, crying out to be free. And Lord, I pray that you will free them right now. May they experience the freedom that comes only through Jesus. May this be their testimony to the world that day by day, person to person, each of us will share your good news. We'll share the story of your salvation. And we will see the gates of Hades come down around us, bar by bar, stone by stone, until your kingdom remains. We pray all these things in your holy name. Amen.
Be still.
Well, that's it for our service today. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. If you haven't already done so, please take a moment to check out those links to the side and down below. Fill out a connection card, sign up for a group, and give online. We're so glad that you decided to be with us today, and we'd like to personally invite you back next week as we continue our series, The Chosen, Season 4. Today, we're going to end with one of our special benediction songs. So let's join together and sing.